Hi everyone and welcome back to my channel called Susanna Reacts, where I learn all things para with your help, and I just share my Slovak Central European point of view. And in today's video, we're going to look into why are Hindu gods so human. And I think we've briefly discussed this in the comments at times. And I have my theory, and I wonder if that video we're going to watch together is going to confirm the theory. And I think before we get into the video, I would love for you to let me know in the comments, why do you think that Hindu gods are so human? And before then, we get into this video.
Please like this video and click on the subscribe button and turn on the notification. Thank you so much for your support.
I'm ready. I am ready to see if my assumption is correct or not.
When we look at the pastimes of the Hindu gods, they end up displaying the most fallible and human of qualities. The child Krishna runs away in fear from his mother Yashoda after breaking pots and eating butter. When Sita is kidnapped by Ravana, Lord Ram is utterly distraught and weeps. When he wishes to rescue her, he needs the help of monkeys to build a bridge and fight for him. Hindus are generally very comfortable with the idea that God can be intensely human in appearance and behavior, but they can often struggle to answer questions about it from those who don't. Christians and Muslims in particular can often be left surprised and confused when they hear about the deeds of the Hindu deities. God is meant to be all-powerful and needs nothing from anyone. And if that is the case, why does he have so many flaws?
I started thinking, how can such character of Ram, Sita, Lakshman, all this be a god? How can I agree that they are gods? When they are not able to save their own family and themselves, how will they save me and my family? You know, if God cannot know what are the evil plans done by the villains and the evil people, how will he know what's happening in the world?
To correct this misunderstanding, we need to get right to the root of the problem. Those Christians and Muslims who believe their religion is the only way to truth follow a salvation theology, and they see everything as leading to a coming apocalypse. There are stories in their scripture of different prophets and saviors warning us about the coming end times. According to these stories, there is a day of judgment approaching, and we need to be ready. Hindus, however, have no idea of an apocalypse. There is no final day of judgment. Instead, Hindus have the concept of Leela. Leela means divine play. It is where God, the supreme reality, takes on limitation for the endearment of his devotees. Whereas those who follow a salvation theology are looking to survive God, Hindus are looking to evolve and actually experience God. Apocalypse is built on the idea that we have...
I don't think that we are in Christianity, people. I don't know about Islam. I don't think that people are trying to survive God. I think they're trying to, yes, that's correct about apocalypse and the end of times. But I don't think the statement about survive, it's very unfamiliar to me, so I'm not too sure where he has taken this from. I think the idea is that you go to heaven and everything is going to be hunky-dory. So basically, the life you live here is shit. Everything's not super great. But if you're a good person, you're going to go to heaven. I think that's the idea. I don't think people... apocalypse is like the end of time. But I don't think people are as focused on this as this video makes it out to be.
One life and the end of the world is coming. Life is like a football match. There is a limited time where the winners go to heaven and the losers are condemned. There is an urgency for everyone to jump on board and believe the right thing. Hindu Leela, however, is founded on the individual evolving over many lives to realize their relationship with God. Unlike Christianity and Islam, time is not linear with a final end of the world. It is an eternal cyclic process where souls and material nature are repeatedly projected out into existence and then withdrawn. Hinduism is not like a football match, but more like the making of a beautiful painting. There are no winners and losers, but there is a gradual manifestation of our connection with the divine. During the various Leelas described in Hinduism, God is intensely human. He becomes like us so that on some level we can understand and relate to him. Through his deeds and pastimes, we gain an insight into his personality and we have the possibility of building a deep, intimate connection with him.
But here's just to pause the fact that Jesus was a God on earth, okay? So it's not just, I mean, I understand it's in a bit of a different way in Hinduism. But it's not just in Hinduism, it's also in Christianity, the God was considered to be Jesus Christ, okay? Let's just make this very, very clear.
Simple descriptions of God's mercy have a limitation. But actually seeing him physically in action with others demonstrates who he is to us. Hindus obviously understand that God needs no one's help. But in the Ramayana, for example, the abduction of Sita shows us the example of devotees around Lord Ram. When we hear about how the monkeys and Hanuman served Ram perfectly in every situation, we realize in ourselves what it is to be a servant of God. We understand what it is to sacrifice and deliver selflessly for a higher cause. God's apparent difficulty allows us to engage and participate with him. The Bhagavad Purana is a scripture which is filled with endless leelas. In the 10th book, It constantly describes the deeds of the all-attractive persona, Krishna. On one hand, we hear about the mischievous thief who steals butter and even eats mud. The next, we are told about how this very same child shows his mother the whole universe in his mouth. Again and again, the Bhagavatam shows the sweet and endearing humanness of Krishna and then contrasts it with Krishna as the ultimate, all-powerful Supreme Lord. Leela is all about God willingly drawing us into a relationship with him and then through that relationship, making us perceive his glory. God in Hinduism does not want to be feared. He wants to be known. He wants to give us the highest joy of loving him. This is why we can have different relationships with him. This is the reason why Krishna is the dear friend of the cowherds, why he is adored as the valiant hero that slays demons, and why he is the lover of the gopis. By God taking on limitation and even appearing vulnerable, we are given different portals of access to know him on a deeper level. Krishna needs nothing. But he engages in Leela for our sake. To experience the truth of God in all his majesty is too difficult for the mind to take. In chapter 11 of the Gita, Arjuna...
Okay, I'll just stop here. I think it's interesting about what he's saying about the relationship, etc. I think to an extent it is similar to Christianity, actually. But... I think when he says that the God shouldn't be feared, and this is a trait of, I think, a God in the Old Testament, although I have my completely different ideas on what I think Old Testament might actually be about. But I think that Christianity has evolved from a God that you should be feared to a loving God. And in fact, Christianity says a God is love, and you know, when in Hinduism, you know, you are basically, that's kind of my spiritual beliefs, that you are a soul on an eternal journey, you're going through many lives, aka, I guess, Hinduism. But because, you know, God is, you know, everything is God. you know, God is in every single one of you. So from that point of view, ocean in a drop in the ocean in the drop type of analogy. Therefore, you know, I can understand where he is coming from. And in fact, someone was shocked when I said that in Christianity, when I was little, and you know, I am a Protestant, Lutheran, evangelic, however you want to call it. We were given the same analogy about God. It's nowhere different. And the person I was speaking to in the comments was surprised about it, but it really does. It's reality. And that's kind of, how, at least in Slovakia, I can tell you that much. So, but let's move on.
Now, he's shocked at the reality of Krishna's cosmic form, and he prays in desperation. After seeing this universal form, which I've never seen before, I'm gladdened. But at the same time, my mind is disturbed with fear. Therefore, please bestow your grace upon me and reveal again that other form, O Lord of the universe. The full manifestation of divinity does not inspire intimacy and love, but rather awe and fear. Our mind, which belongs to this physical world, cannot tolerate its magnificence. This is why God takes on a form. The important...
This is what I would... have maybe a different point of view. I think I don't personally need to have many different gods. I feel like we have a direct access to the Brahman. And I personally don't feel like you needed a personification, but I think this is all a personal decision and personal view, right? Like everyone has their own spiritual journey. And if that is what helps you, it's to you, right? I don't think there's anything right or wrong about that, right? It is just your experience, your journey, and doing what makes it easier, helpful for you to be a better person ultimately.
The thing to realize is that although the relationships with Krishna are described in human terms, they are actually divine.
Interesting.
The devotees around Krishna are utterly surrendered to him. When we read about the different events, we see how they have given up their own will, how their hearts and minds are entirely absorbed in him. Leela is as much about the perfected devotees as it is about God himself. Meditation and contemplation on these Leelas purifies us. It causes us in some way to enter into that same Leela with the Lord himself. And as this happens, the Lord's deeds become the reality of the relationship we are looking to achieve. Mainstream Islam has no real concept of Leela, since it is entirely blasphemous for God to take on any form. In fact, for many Muslims, it would be considered the worst of all sins. But one could argue that the story of Jesus is a Leela, since it is God who has taken on a limitation for the benefit of mankind. There is some truth in this, in that the personality of God becomes revealed through the actions of Christ. His compassion and love for humanity shows God's love for this world. From this point of view, one can draw a number of parallels with the bhakti traditions of Hinduism. But so long as a Christian believes Christ is the only way, then the emphasis on Christ's life is based more on an apocalyptic scenario than on Hindu Leela. Because for them, the advent of Christ is more about being saved from damnation than realizing his love. What makes this idea of Leela so profound is that it accepts the paradox of God, who is unknowable, omnipresent, and all-powerful, existing simultaneously in a material, limited form. Any tradition which accepts the notion of the avatar, where the Lord incarnates in form, is always filled with mysticism and produces various saints who have attained spiritual heights. Seeing the unlimited in the limited and the infinite in the finite naturally opens the door to a deeper spiritual perspective. Leela is all about God crossing down, taking on a name and form, walking and talking like us so that we can aspire to know him. Seeing the outside display of the qualities of God and his devotees awakens these same qualities within. This is how surrender, grace, and love grow inside us. This is why Hinduism treasures these Leelas in songs, poetry, and performances. Whatever we give attention to becomes stronger, and by worshipping these Leelas, we humble ourselves, allowing their reality to govern our life. Krishna states, "I am never manifest to the foolish and unintelligent. For them, I am covered by my power of illusion, my yoga maya. And so the deluded world knows me not as the unborn and infallible." To those who do not have the depth of perception, they judge the Leelas of Hinduism in the most shallow and ignorant of ways. They are unable to perceive the divinity that lies behind them. The mind and normal physical eyes bound to this world cannot know God. Before Arjuna is able to see Krishna's cosmic form on the battlefield, he is blessed by him to have divine eyes. In the same way, all spiritual practice in Hinduism is designed to attain these divine eyes. Once we have them, we will understand the truth behind the divine Leelas of the Lord. We will see that there is a loving God who is longing to know us even more than we are longing to know him.
This is very interesting video. Very interesting. Now, when he ended, was about God being loving, but that's kind of what Christianity teaches, you know. So that's where I'm struggling to, let's say, maybe see a difference between, let's say, Christianity and Hinduism. I personally consider myself spiritual, but he also said, like, yeah, the Christianity to Christ is the only way, because Christ has said, I'm the truth, I'm the way, and who comes to me, I'm just trying to back translate from Slovak. I think it's a long, like, that you can only go to God through me. But the challenge, for example, I might have at Christianity is that I know for a fact that it has been manipulated in order, like, this is why when I started to study history, I was like, no way, I believe in this, because it feels so manipulated. It's so, you know, many things perhaps even misinterpreted. And in a way, I would see, you know, Jesus Christ, it is clear that it's like a God in a human form. The guy had said that in the video. But I think when it comes to Christianity, it has been vastly manipulated to fit a certain narrative. I think it's instead of focusing on the lessons, which there were good lessons that Jesus had been teaching, it has been manipulated, which is a shame, because he's almost like a prophet, and some might see him as a prophet. But there are things like Christ consciousness, and I feel like, you know, he is an analogy that comes to me. You guys perhaps would not understand unless you studied linguistics. he's an allomorph of a morph, you know, he's just one personification of God. And I think, you know, what the Hinduism is talking about is, you know, you are a soul that evolves over many lifetimes. So there would be different Jesuses in this kind of world. And I wonder sometimes where the line about, like, I'm the truth, I'm the way is, because I'm sure it was said, but you know how things are being said in and out of the context. And I'm sure it was also in those days. And if these words have been even properly understood, they're just such a huge room for misinterpretation. But I do believe that Christianity also teaches that you have to have, well, not that you have to have, it's about a loving God. It's about having a connection with a God. So that's actually kind of very interesting, that there perhaps, I really don't know anything about Islam, but there seem to be a lot of similarities. I was very intrigued by the concept of lilas. I actually didn't quite understand it, to be honest. So if you could help me understand what those lilas are in the comments, that would be super duper helpful. Yeah, because I think that the lilas is what scriptures that teach you about your relationship with God. And again, if we consider that everything is God, which it really, I guess, is, but then it does depend on your belief system, right? You don't have to agree with me, but I come from the point where if everything is God, then everyone is God. Every single thing is divine. So hence you would, you could call yourself a God in a way, if you like, to make it a bit more human. But nonetheless, I personally don't believe you need to have these gods in order to connect to the source. I like to perhaps call it the source. but I get the whole personification, because that just teaches us about, in a way, how to be a better human being, which which can then achieve perhaps moksha, enlightenment, what have you. And so very, very interesting. And I said that I would promise to tell you at the end what I thought this could be about. And I thought, I think it was. So I think what I thought originally was that you need to have a person with a human quality to show you what it could look like, act like, to be a god, which I presume that's what he had said pretty much in the video. So my assumption was correct. And with that being said, thank you so much for watching this video with me. If you did enjoy, please give a thumbs up, share, like, and subscribe to this channel, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then, please do take care. I'm sending much, much love. Bye-bye.